Given all the action and martial arts in a franchise like the Power Rangers, the 2017 movie suits are great examples of doing an armored costume design while also creating a high level of mobility in that design. Here I'm going to cover some of the fundamentals in how these suits are designed so you could possibly learn from them and apply their techniques to creating whatever costume you're looking to do in the future, whether it be out of foam, Warbla, or some other plastics or rubbers, etc. The key things I'm going to cover in this video is breaking down the flexible undersuit they used, embracing the negative space in the armor pieces, and creating armor pieces out of flexible materials instead of always using hard materials. As you can see here, I have a picture of the Red Ranger suit. So first, let's quickly touch on the bottom layer, the undersuit of the actual whole suit. If we zoom in more closely on some of these shots, you can see here underneath the arm here, we have folds in the material, letting us know that these undersuits are actually a very thin material, and they're probably a four-way or two-way stretch sort of material so that they can fit the body very closely while still stretching and giving as needed. Here's another shot of the Red Ranger, and if you look closely here, you can see that as he's walking, there's quite a bit of fold within the material here, which shows you how really thin the undersuit actually is. On top of the undersuits, they also did some sort of screen printing to add some sort of texture and detail so it's not just flat. So this detail is purely cosmetic to give it a little bit more of a feel as if it's actual armor when on the screen. So as for the armor pieces themselves, we'll start at the top and work our way down. Looking at the neck here, you see there's quite a bit of negative space where it's just the thin fabric undersuit, but they have added some bits of what you'd almost say scaled armor. They've overlapped small thin pieces of armor, so it gives the impression of actual armor, but still allows a lot of flexibility in the neck. So working our way down, looking at this piece that covers the top of the trapezius muscles is actually separate from the chest and the shoulder right here. You can see it actually sits underneath the chest piece here and underneath the shoulder piece right here. And this is likely a flexible rubber as opposed to a hard plastic. So given that it's broken up, it's separate from the chest and the shoulder pieces, and it's made out of a firm but flexible rubber, it allows for a lot of shoulder movement. Now it's likely this piece right here is a separate piece that's glued on top of this piece here, but overall it's relatively small, so it's minimal at hindering movement. Now it's pretty clear here the shoulder piece is a separate piece all in of itself. It's likely glued to the undersuit, just like this piece right here is glued directly to the undersuit. Now the chest piece here, you'll find something interesting that you rarely see in movie designs, is that there's a lot of negative space right here in the front of the chest where the chest connects with the armpit. This is to allow for a high level of mobility when it comes to forward movement, punching, etc., things like that. Instead of filling this area in, which is pretty traditional when it comes to designing full chest armor, they've really put priority mobility over a fully armored look and design. So they've really embraced that mobility and incorporated it into the design here. So as a whole, looking at this chest piece, you can see it's actually relatively small, allowing for a high level of mobility in the chest area. It overlaps the abs here, but it's not attached to the abs. Now working our way down to the upper arm, you see again, we have a separate small piece that covers the biceps, but you see here they've actually broken up into two separate pieces. You see this larger piece here covers the primary part of the bicep, but they've extended the design by adding a smaller piece that fits underneath the bicep. And looking at the finish of this material, I'm pretty sure this is a soft rubber because we're getting really close to the inside of the elbow here where the arm bends, and they didn't want the whole bicep piece to hinder movement in the suit. So what they've done is they've broken it up. You've got your larger piece that covers the primary part of the bicep, while you've got a smaller piece near the bottom that extends the design that still allows for a high level of mobility. Now the forearm pieces of the gauntlets are pretty straightforward. They've got a whole piece that covers the majority of the forearm, but they've broken it up at the wrist, and they've added a piece that overlaps and fits on the back side of the hand. And up here, again, you'll see they've added more low profile armor pieces, but it is likely a more flexible, thinner material, just like this bicep piece right here. So it extends the armor design, but it's not going to hinder mobility. Here's one thing I was a little surprised and really liked that they did. They broke up the whole entire abs into four separate pieces, and they very clearly overlap each other. And I'm really glad they embraced it and just incorporated it into the design. And looking further into the torso area, you gotta recognize there's going to be a lot of movement around in this area, a lot of twisting, leaning forward, leaning back, etc. So what they did on the sides here is they went for some very low profile pieces. They didn't do any overlap. They aren't larger pieces like the chest here or the shoulder pieces. They recognized they wanted a lot of movement in here. And if they went for larger pieces like chest or shoulder pieces, one, this gives a more superhero streamlined design with a thinner waist, but it also allows for a high level of flexibility given how small and separate these pieces are. Now coming to the leg area, just like in the chest, where we have all this negative space to allow for a high level of movement, they didn't want to hinder any sort of movement whatsoever. So you see that there's no armor that runs up to the top of the hip here. And when you get into the groin area, it's very open. Again, we have very low profile separate pieces that don't overlap to aid in that high level of mobility. It's tougher for me to tell how flexible these materials are here, but given their location, their low profile, a high level of flexibility isn't as big of a deal as it would be when it comes to having a piece like this up in the bicep. Now, one thing that I do suspect, looking at these pieces here on the insides and comparing the finish to these pieces here, this is likely a pretty flexible urethane rubber, and this is going to be a firmer type of possible rubber or plastic. They recognize if getting so close to the hip joint and the groin area, they need this material to be very flexible, to be comfortable for the stuntmen, the actors, and allow for that, again, that high level of mobility. And here we come down to the kneecap. The kneecap looks like you have one large piece right here, and underneath, again, you have, similar to the bicep, a thinner lower profile material that is much more flexible, that's going to stretch and bend when the knee's bent, allowing for a high level of mobility. And then looking at the boots here, they're actually not boots. They have a piece that covers the shin and the calf, and then it's separated right at the ankle here to allow maximum flexibility. And then they've added a bit of additional armor, boot-like armor. So they give the impression of a boot, but they're definitely not your traditional sense of a boot. Here's a shot of the Blue Ranger, slightly profile. We can get a better shot of the arm here. You can see that the bicep, the front is separate from the back, the tricep, and that forearm piece, you've got the larger piece here, and then you've got the overlap of the thinner, more flexible piece. And if you take a look here, you can see the boot-like design. They've got a separate front piece to the back piece. And you can see here these folds. They've actually used a very flexible material, at least in this scene, a very flexible material to create the boot-like design while still having that armored look. Something like this you wouldn't notice in a fast-moving scene, or this would be doctored, changed up in post before the movie's finished. Now, I haven't been able to find a lot of great shots of the backs of the suits, but the same principles apply to the rest of the suit when it comes to the back design. The back design is actually, for the most part, a pretty low profile design with a lot of segmented separate pieces. You don't have a large back piece, relatively speaking, compared to like the chest. And you can basically apply what you see here of a lot of the negative space and flexible materials. You can actually apply to the backside also. Another thing that I'd like to point out is when you look at the backside of the leg here, you can see there's a lot of negative space in the backside of the leg. They didn't cover that up, and the boot design drops quite a bit. This is something to keep in mind and created an armor design. Something that you might underestimate, if you're creating a large bit of armor on the backside here, it will dramatically hinder your movement. As you can see here, there's a lot of negative space in the design, and it's almost completely just undersuit at the back of the knee here and the back of the thigh. So I hope you found this video informative, gave you some ideas on creating future suits and whatnot. So if you like this, please hit the like button below. If you have any questions, please comment in the comment section below. If you want to look at these high-res pictures that I've used in this video, there's a link in the description below so you can take a look at them. Just a quick caveat, I have not talked directly with the people that designed and created these suits. All of this is speculation based off of what I have done personally in the past in designing my own suits, particularly when it comes to designing suits like this here. In my research, it's not 100% clear who had their hands in designing the physical fabrication of these suits. It looks like Weta Workshop worked on these suits, so I want to give a shout out to them for all the work that they did. If any of you know any other parties that actually worked on the practical part of these suits, including the digital, feel free to comment in the section below. Thanks for watching.